Thank you for keeping it Urban TV. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and I hope out there you're still sanitizing. I hope you're still social distancing. I hope you're still wearing your mask. And most importantly, I hope you've been vaccinated, because COVID-19 is still real and it is still ravaging our society. The only way we can keep our economies open while at it is by getting vaccinated. Today we are going to be talking about regional integration and its challenges. And my guest tonight is a distinguished scholar, Dr. Frederick Goloba Mtebi. He's an independent researcher and political and governance analyst. Doctor, welcome to the set.
Thank you.
Doctor, during his sixth inauguration in office, President Yoweri Museveni highlighted as key amongst his agenda in the 5 years, regional integration. He said it's very important that we, as a country, as a region, we fast track the East African Community integration, political federation at that level. But I keep wondering, with the cross-border challenges we are having with Kenya, with Tanzania, Uganda, with Rwanda, do you think regional integration is something that can be fast-tracked in the near future? Is Museveni's aspiration feasible in these 5 years?
If you talk of integration, integration is not something that President Museveni can determine in terms of whether it happens or not. He wants it to happen, but for it to happen, he must have others alongside him who want this to happen as badly as he wants it to happen. So he might have expressed it as one of his aspirations for this term, but for it to happen quickly and in the way that he wants it to happen, he must have the support or agreement of other leaders who lead countries that our own country, Uganda, wants to integrate with. So that's not something that is within his capacity to determine whether it happens or not.
But in your assessment, do you see the leaders of Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda, Burundi, South Sudan, most recently the Democratic Republic of Congo, is in the process? But when you assess these leaders, is this an aspiration that they are looking up to, or it's just a bubble in President Yoweri Museveni's head?
Well, if you listen to all the leaders, each one individually expresses those aspirations. But as I said, there is a difference between expressing an aspiration or an objective and actually getting it to happen. Now, integration is not something that happens within a short period of time. It certainly can't happen within the presidential term of any president, a single presidential term. Integration happens over a very long period of time. It's a process that has to be pursued with commitment, consistently, and with a willingness to be flexible about certain things. Now, whether all our leaders are equally committed, whether they are equally prepared to pursue this consistently, that is a question that is very difficult to answer. One can only answer it by looking at country per country. But if we were, for instance, to think about the internal political climate in some of these countries, it is such that it makes it very difficult for them to concentrate on the objective of integration. Look at South Sudan. They are constantly trying to resolve their own internal problems. Every now and then fights break out. They haven't even been able to stabilize internally since they got independence. So I would presume that in itself takes up much more time than they can dedicate to the issue of integration. Burundi has had repeated problems of a similar kind. There was at some point a failed coup, then the president died, then even the current government is torn by dissensions internally. If you look at Uganda, we have our own internal problems. So the kinds of things that presidents have to deal with within their own countries are such that integration, even if they wanted it to happen, it can only happen over a long period of time because they're juggling several balls at the same time. Mm.
But when you listen to them keenly, they, albeit the internal challenges that African states face, they seem to be arguing that the only magic bullet to resolving the Africa's challenges as a whole is for regions to integrate and ultimately the continental integration. So why is it that important? But then it looks like a far cry at the same time.
Yeah, but precisely because integration cannot solve all our problems, that is why even efforts spent on trying to achieve it haven't really solved the internal problems that countries have to deal with. I mean, I don't see how integration within East Africa is going to solve the security challenges of the Democratic Republic of Congo. There are dozens of insurgent groups in that country, all seeking to do different things. Some of them are pursuing agendas in Uganda, others are pursuing agendas in Rwanda, others are pursuing agendas in Burundi, others are pursuing internal agendas within Congo. How is integration going to solve that? If this region cannot come together to help the Democratic Republic of Congo solve its internal problems, even before integration, how is it going to happen as a result of integration? There's no magic bullet to these things.
Perhaps it's the concept that the structure might not be, the structure of the region might not be able to resolve but the concept of integrating might.
No, I think that countries have individually to pursue political stability internally, first of all, so that presidents are not preoccupied by issues of security, issues of fighting insurgents, issues of trying to subdue internal dissent, for them to pay sufficient attention to integration. Our leaders, first of all, also have to pay attention to issues of interstate relations. Now, if interstate relations are troubled in the way that you mentioned in the beginning, say, for instance, between Rwanda and Uganda, between Uganda and Kenya, you can't pursue integration with the kind of attention it deserves when you have all those things happening. So I think that the idea that integration is going to solve all our problems is a bit of a deception. I really don't believe it.
So under what parameters do you think can integration happen?
Integration can best happen or can happen fairly quickly among countries that are internally settled, internally peaceful, where political contestations are not of the kind or of the intensity that we see in some countries. You can't get DRC to integrate fully into the East African region. You can't get South Sudan to do the same or Burundi until you have found a mechanism for helping them to stabilize internally. You can't get countries that are at loggerheads with each other pursuing integration. I mean, that in itself is a contradiction in terms. So integration can best be pursued by countries that are at peace, first of all, with each other, and that are also at peace and that are stable internally. Then at least leaders can then pay attention, they can work towards integration. But you can't say, let's pursue integration first and then we will look at our internal problems. I don't think that that's the best way to do it.
That then begs the question, how can African countries resolve the governance, internal governance questions before even talking about integration?
Well, the best way to solve internal governance questions is first of all for the political elite in each country to decide among themselves what it is that is important for them as groups, different groups contending for power, but also for the country. Now, if you have different political groups in any country constantly fighting each other for power and disagreeing about almost everything, how can any of them realistically sit down and begin to pay full attention to issues of integration or issues of cooperation with other states? Now, only countries where what we call rules of the game have been agreed and settled, where political competition has been defined in terms of how it happens, so that it happens peacefully so that it ends and then people begin to look at what it is that they should do collectively, are able to do things of the kind that we aspire to do at regional level. But if you have countries that are torn by internal contestations, internal civil wars, you really can't realistically achieve integration.
But in your assessment, why does the political class, because if this is very fundamental, why is it that then the political class is unable to address this?
Well, that is a very difficult question for me to answer. If you ask me why, for instance, in Uganda, is it difficult for the ruling party to sit down with other parties to try and agree a way forward so that we get out of this cycle of contestation that happens all the time, so that we don't have to continue bickering and quarreling among ourselves after every election, I don't know what prevents them from doing it. But if you listen to President Museveni very carefully, he refers to opposition groups as enemies. Now, how can you possibly work with your enemies? How can you convince people that you refer to as enemies to cooperate with you? So I think that in every country, the political elite must find a solution, must find a formula for cooperating. Now, some countries have achieved this to a much greater extent than others, but again, we have to bear in mind that ours are still young countries. There are many things that we haven't mastered to do. There are people even who argue that our attempts at building conventional multi-party systems are quite wrong-headed, that we are not ready for that kind of politics. But for us to come to a point where we work together more than working against each other, it requires a lot of effort on the part of political leaders and those that want to displace them, or those that want to get to power, and those who want to keep it.
But are we, when you look at the way our society is organized, do you think we are really ready to for this kind of liberal democracy and conventional organization of political parties and systems?
My personal view is that we are not. If you look at any country, for me, one of my objections to competitive politics, the way we define it, is that it's first of all extremely expensive. We spend millions of dollars on conducting presidential campaigns, on organizing elections. Now, elections are rarely free and fair. So we spend money organizing campaigns and elections, after which we then set upon each other and start fighting about it. So they are costly, they are destabilizing, and therefore they distract leaders from doing those things that are important, from thinking about those things that they should be thinking about, things like integration. So personally, I think that we ought to find a different way of doing politics that allows us to live within stable environments, that allows us to spend more time thinking creatively about how to solve our problems than fighting each other for power. So my personal view is, no, we are not ready for that. It is a good thing, we could do it, but maybe at a later date, not right now.
So how then can we better organize society for our society other than political contestation? There are schools of thought that perhaps we could think about more organically grown ways of organizing society as opposed to the liberal democracy that we are practicing and we don't believe in.
I would agree with that. I mean, if you remember, when President Museveni and the NRM first arrived here, or when they first took over power, they came up with the idea of an all-encompassing system in which people would participate on the basis of individual merit, where political party activity was to be suspended for a while. I think that the first 10 years showed Ugandans that actually that approach to politics was far superior to what we had had before. And if you look at how far we've come since we got rid of the movement and went multi-party, you can see the disruptions that have happened. You can see that politics in Uganda has become much more angry, It has become much more oppressive. It has become much more violent. So I think that the idea that President Museveni and his colleagues in the NRM came with of the movement and no party system was a good one for that time. But I think eventually people were overcome by their own instincts of contesting for power in adversarial terms, and we killed that system, went conventional multipartism, and you can see where we are now. This country is very tense almost all the time. People are very angry in this country. And I attribute all the anger and the tensions to multi-party politics, multi-party contestation in the way that we have organized it. So I could also add that I personally blame President Museveni and the NRM for the collapse of the movement idea, because much as they continued to talk in terms of no-party politics, they began to behave like a political party, and therefore forced others to form, to revert to the multi-party politics of old. But I think that that idea was a nice one, and it's a pity that we abandoned it and went back to the same kind of politics that had plunged this country into chaos in the 1960s before Idi Amin came to power.
So is it possible to generate consensus for people to realize that the direction we are taking is a wrong direction? We need to innovate new ideas of how to organize our society. Can we generate that kind of consensus, and then how can we do that?
You know, the whole idea of leaders means that people should lead others. When President Museveni and the NRM came to power and presented us with the idea of no party politics, it's not ordinary Ugandans that came with it. Ordinary Ugandans were presented with this idea, and they were convinced that it was well worth trying. And I think that even as we speak now, if this idea of rebuilding consensus came from the leadership of this country, if they started by convincing those that contest for power with them, or those that want to displace them, and convince them that we actually now need to change direction, I think it would be fairly easy to convince the rest of the population that maybe we need to change course again. Having said that, I think that President Museveni and the NRM have depleted the kind of trust that Ugandans had in them all those years when they first arrived on the scene. I'm not sure that other politicians or political groups in this country are willing to trust President Museveni the way he was trusted, say, in 1986. So while I think it's possible, it's going to be much more difficult. In the absence of trust, you cannot get it to happen.
Going back to the original question, when you look at, for example, what's happening in the Europe, the whole, these are well-organized societies. They have agreed on the rules of the game. They have agreed to do their politics a certain way, to organize their societies a certain way, and they are advanced in terms of leadership. But they are equally disintegrating into their small enclaves. For example, using the example of Brexit. What assurance do you have that if we organize ourselves a certain way, then we shall be able to advance to integration?
There is no system that remains static. Political systems evolve. Political systems keep changing. And people in any country, or people in any region, all countries that are members to any kind of association like the EU, must be flexible enough to change with the times. So even us here, whatever system we adopted, it can't be permanently useful. It can't be permanently capable of responding to emerging needs or emerging imperatives. So the important thing is for people who provide leadership to keep adjusting as times change. Now, you mentioned Brexit. The UK was part of the European Union for a very long time, but I think the time came when they felt the European Union was no longer advancing their interests, at least in the way they understood them. And for that reason, they chose that it would be better for them to leave that association and forge on their own. But those that stayed have stayed, and the European Union has continued to forge ahead in the way that it was doing before Brexit. So even this, the East African community into which we want to integrate, if we succeed, to create a functioning East African community that does these kinds of things that we want it to do, there is no guarantee that 40, 50 years down the road, all countries will want to remain in the East African community. There are those that might want to leave. Equally, there are those that might want to come in. So no political system is cast in stone. I think change is healthy in every system, and change must be provided for, and it must be prepared for.
But you must agree that globally the spirit of nationalism is attracting more support as opposed to this whole thing of integration and all that. So why would Africa be heading to a direction where the rest are starting to reflect upon whether globalization really works?
I'm not sure that there has been a period in world history where nationalism has not been a force to reckon with. Now, talking about the European Union, the EU, at least in its original intentions, was forged in order to tone down the forces of nationalism. If you look again at Brexit, the British felt we are being stifled by the EU. We could do better on our own. Were they driven by forces of nationalism? I'm not sure. I think that they were driven more by economic interest. They feel they can do better relating more with their former colonies or the Commonwealth group of countries, that they can relate better with the EU outside of it than inside of it. So I see it as much more of an economic issue rather than one of nationalism or political feeling. Now, here in East Africa, again, I think that we have a tendency to think that integration is just about economics alone. No, integration is both about economics and politics. Now, what is it that is driving us politically towards integration? I'm not sure that I know what it is, because the key justification for the re-establishment of the East African community was the large market it was going to create, and therefore the facility it was going to give enterprises to trade and for countries to trade with each other. But I think that if we were being driven more by political imperatives, maybe we would integrate a bit faster than the economic ones.
Countries like Uganda, multi-ethnic, Africa generally, how then do, now looking at the broader concept of integration, how do smaller societies, say Buganda, relate with the rest, just in case the integration happens, relate with the bigger society, if just in case it does happen?
Well, you see, this is why I told you from the beginning that integration is not an answer to any problem. At least it's not an answer to internal problems of any country. Now, for Buganda, the question of how Buganda relates to the rest of the East African community would not arise if Buganda was comfortable within Uganda. Now, for Uganda to be comfortable within Uganda, that must be settled through an internal political process within Uganda itself. Therefore, we have, first of all, to look at our own internal situation. What are the things that cause dissensions in this country? What are things that are potential destabilizers of this country? What are things that we keep fighting about? What are unsettled questions that we need to settle? Now, once we have settled outstanding questions in this country, once we have dealt with those factors that are potentially destabilizing, we can then comfortably walk into the East African community, because we have no problems internally. We have solved them. If we don't solve internal problems, then the questions of regions like how Buganda relates to the rest of the East Africa, then they become relevant. But if Buganda was comfortable in Uganda, if Buganda wasn't making any demands on the Ugandan state, if Buganda's concerns have been settled, that question doesn't arise. I really don't see it arising.
Thank you. Moving on, Uganda has had a stalemate of a relationship with its neighboring country, Rwanda, who you would by and large say brothers and sisters. But what do you make of these renewed efforts to try and resolve these issues? We've seen the Gatuna border being opened, we've seen leaders cross over and all that. But do you think that now settles the issue that has been at hand?
I don't think so. The tensions or the conflict between Rwanda and Uganda are long-standing. These things date from the 1990s. They can't be resolved in one night or in one week. They are problems that are very old. They are new problems as well. The reopening of the border, which we have seen in recent times, is the beginning of a process through which these problems are going to be resolved. Now, is that a positive step? I think it is. But let's not fool ourselves and think that, you know, this is going to happen very quickly, or it's going to, now that the border is open, the problems have been solved. I don't think they have. I think they are of such a kind that they can only be resolved over time through very deliberate processes and engagements. And we shouldn't think that this is going to be easy, that it's just a matter of one envoy going from Uganda to Rwanda and then the problems are solved, unless you don't know what the problems are. But as far as I know them, they are quite serious, deep problems that require a great deal of engagement, that require a great deal of listening to each other, that require a great deal of flexibility on both sides, and that require a great deal of understanding. Now, we Ugandans have this tendency of saying, you know, Rwanda and Uganda, one country, we are brothers and sisters and so on. Why don't we say the same thing about South Sudan or Kenya or Tanzania or DRC? I think that we are sisters and brothers with Rwanda in the same way that we are with all these other neighboring countries. And the reason why we have had problems with Rwanda, I think, have to do with the fact that, okay, we had a lot of Rwandans living here, and, I mean, they were Ugandans, literally, for a very long time. And I think that we got used to the idea that these were people that we could influence in ways that we can't influence other countries. And I think we have never got used to the fact that Rwanda is a sovereign state that has to be respected in the same way that Kenya is, that Tanzania is, that South Sudan is, that DRC is. So, yeah, I think that the reopening of the border is a positive step, but let's not assume that it solves every problem that there is.
If you allow me a little latitude, I'd like to pick your insight into what you think is the root cause of this, and why is in one of President Paul Kagame's recent speeches about the relationship, he said he still referred to the root cause of these problems as opposed to just the. What do you think is exactly the problem and how can it be resolved?
From my understanding, and not to get into too much into details, I think that the root cause of the problem is that we haven't known how to deal with each other. I think we must find a way of dealing with each other in ways that preserve mutual respect, in ways that show or suggest to whoever might be watching that these are two sovereign states that are dealing with each other as sovereign states, not in sort of the casual way in which we sometimes want to deal with each other, or in the casual ways in which some people might want to deal with Rwanda. For me, I think that that's where the problem is. And I spend quite a lot of time in Rwanda. I live here as well. I think that the issue is really one of finding a formula for dealing with each other in the context of mutual respect.
Mm. But without trying to apportion blame, do you think this problem is shared from both sides, or it simply emanates from a Big Brother syndrome, or it cuts across? Rwanda must learn how to relate with Uganda, and Uganda must also learn how to relate with Rwanda.
Well, I'm not going to add any detail to what I say to you, that we need to learn how to deal with each other in ways that preserve in ways that create or preserve mutual respect. Whether this must be done more by Uganda or by Rwanda, well, I wouldn't say. But I think that the problem is knowing how to deal with each other.
But Uganda's relationship with Rwanda doesn't seem like it's not an isolated case. But when you look at the entire Great Lakes, Kenya has issues with Somalia, Ethiopia has issues with Sudan, Uganda's trade relation with Kenya is on and off, Uganda and Rwanda, Rwanda and Burundi. What exactly could be causing these cross-border issues for the entire Great Lakes region?
Well, that's a very broad question. I think that every situation has to be analyzed on its own terms. What is the problem between Somalia and Kenya? I think the problem is more territorial than anything else. What is the problem between, say, Burundi and Rwanda? I think you may have heard that there have been accusations that Burundi blames Rwanda for certain things that happened in Burundi, that Burundi claims that people who tried to mount a coup in Burundi have run to Rwanda and Rwanda has refused to hand them over. If you look at the situation, say, between DRC and Rwanda as it used to be before they moved to a fairly significant degree of rapprochement, again, it had to do with Rwandan rebels hiding in Congo and causing, threatening the stability of Rwanda. So I think every problem has to be analyzed on its own merits. It's not, the problems are not similar. The approaches to resolving them cannot be similar. But I think that these reflect normal contestations that arise between neighbors, between neighboring countries, depending on what is happening across their borders. There have been problems between Tanzania and Kenya. You may have heard that when President Magufuli was still around, Kenyan pastoralists were not being allowed to graze their cattle in Tanzania. Their cattle were impounded and auctioned. So again, the cause of that problem can't possibly be the same or be similar to the cause of problems between Rwanda and Uganda. So every situation demands its own deep analysis for one to understand what it is, and therefore to suggest possible solutions.
What do these kind of challenges mean for landlocked countries like Uganda? If we are time and again on and off with Kenya over trade, what is the impact of those kinds of challenges on the lay Ugandan and the trader? And what would they make of the whole facade of integration and the East African community?
Well, every time two countries have conflicts of a trade-related kind, of course it does have an impact on their economies. Now, if Kenya says, look, we are not going to accept the imports of milk or maize or eggs from Uganda, it does impact negatively on producers of these goods. Now, what should happen? I think that what should happen is that Uganda and Kenya, or the leaderships of both countries, should sit down and try to diagnose the root cause of these tensions that come up every now and then, and therefore find a long-lasting solution to them. Anything besides that, I don't see what can be done. I think that there has to be a deliberate effort to create understanding, to create a willingness to resolve problems whenever they might crop up and to resolve them quickly. Now, if you find rigidities in one country, if you find unwillingness in one country to solve a problem, or if you find that the nature of institutional setups in one country are such that there is inertia in terms of moving towards resolving a problem, these things can only continue.
Okay, well, with that, Doctor, let's go for a very short break.